Whoa, and welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera, Blind. I'm the RPG Chick. We are continuing our exploration of the Valley of Dead Heroes. This guy has three faces and he wants a fourth face. Oh, Thalana Makarath is up there. Oh, and blocked past a cone village. Cool. Okay, what's this cat thing here?
I'm ready.
We can examine it and stuff from this far away. Rising before you is a tall and tapering obelisk crowned with the carved stone head of some elegant, sharp-eared animal with six eyes. Wrapping around the obelisk are bands of engraved hieroglyphs. Examine the stone head. The carved head mounted on top of the obelisk stares out into the distance, its eyes empty and mournful. Stares out into space, the hieroglyphs. Except for four stylized depictions of the same sharp-eared animal that tops the obelisk, the pictographs make no sense to you. Four of the pictographs are stylized versions of this animal. The animal this obelisk was meant to depict, but you can still make no sense of the hieroglyphs' meaning. Examine the base of the obelisk. It is smooth, untouched by any weathering or other troubles that seem to have eroded much of the other ruins in this place. It sits in a pool of acrid liquid. The liquid smells foul and caustic, but the obelisk appears undamaged. It's unclear how much more of the obelisk lies beneath the pool. The statue's head seems to move until its eyes stare directly into yours. Okay, they are still mournful, but no longer empty. A faint beckoning glimmer shines within. You turn to your companions, but they don't seem to notice that anything strange has happened. Look into the statue's eyes. A wave of dizziness overcomes you as you gaze into the statue's eyes. You are no longer facing the obelisk. Indeed, you are no longer human. I'm not. The tail of the dead lac in your mouth drags along the ground as you creep through the dense foliage to the temple. You peek out through the gandu fronds and see the old monk, Nimu, shucking heopods on the weathered steps. You pad out to greet him, and he grins toothlessly at the sight of you. There she is. There's my brave hunter, and with a gift. How thoughtful. Okay, so I'm now a three-eyed feline. Oh, sorry, six-eyed feline. You drop the lac at his feet and arch your back as he strokes your fur and adjusts your collar. But your work isn't done, sweet girl. There's lacs aplenty in the grain room. Bring me a dozen more before I finish these hayos, and I'll give you your favorite nibble. A dozen lacs is nothing to a hunter of your skill. You pad off to the granary, ready for battle. The obelisk reappears, and you realize your joy was remembered only. The base of the obelisk is smooth, untouched by weathering or the caustic-smelling pool it sits in. Look into the eyes to see what else it has to show me. Another wave of dizziness overcomes you as you succumb to the statue's memories. You watch from the undergrowth, terrified, as the followers of the bird god pull down the stone statues of the Great Ones and chase the monks from the burning temple. "Heathen!" cries their leader. "Worshippers of false gods, kill them all!" A birdman sees you. He shrieks, "A sea turtle! We must kill it! The monks hide their souls in the little beasts! If you don't wipe them out, the monks will return, as strong as ever." You turn and bound into the jungle as a mob of angry men crash after you, and the obelisk fills your vision again. A citurl? So that's what this creature is called. Anything else? You watch from a low branch as grave robbers tear up the stones of the ruined temple's nave, looking for the old catacombs. Their leader sits on the stone head of a fallen statue, patting it and stroking its pointed ears. He laughs. "This is what the old monks worshipped before the Gerudi wiped them out. The Prince of the Sea Turtle. They say his big ears hear all the secrets ever whispered within earshot of any of those six-eyed pests. You hiss at the insult. He looks up. Hoy, there's one now. Hasn't been a monk alive around here to tame a sea turtle in 100 years. He chirps at you. Come here, little one. Let me see that jeweled collar of yours, won't you? Looks like lovely workmanship. You give him a disdainful look and climb further up the tree as the obelisk returns. I like this thing, the sea turtle. The memory fades and the obelisk returns. Anything else? You watch from under a gandu bush as the father and mother drop double armloads of springwood into the middle of the temple ruins, then sit and mop their brows as their three children begin stripping the stalks of their bark. Plenty to build with out here, at least, says the father. And we'll need all we can get, says the mother. Without a perimeter fence to keep out the balls and the skullhounds, we'd be dead in a week. What about the lax? One of the children cries. The father laughs. Pray to Guni, daughter. Maybe he'll send one of his servants for us. He's the prince of all sea turtle, you know. Your ears prick up. At last you are wanted. It's time to hunt. The eyes of the statue fade, though they do not go out entirely, as though it has divested itself of a responsibility. Why it did so remains a mystery. And why would eyes not going out entirely be a divestiture of responsibility? Anything else? Revisit the memories? It's the same thing. Yeah. Alright. Interesting. Very interesting. What is this? The glowing liquid seeps out from cracks deep within this central hill. Okay, we've been down there. That's where we came from. We've seen that. Those guys we talked to. Okay. Can we go up here? No. We have to find our way up there. Wait.
In an instant.
I couldn't move there. Oh, unreachable, I see. I was like, wait a second, maybe we can go in there, because I'm clicking everything and nothing's working. Unreachable, right? These packs are lived out of, but appear ready to leave at a moment's notice. They smell faintly of herbs and ozone. I assure you that I am aware. Assurances are fine. Actions are better. Show me. One moment. We have to go through one of these portals to get to these other areas.
All right.
I think it's one of those memorialists who told us that most of the traveling is done by going through these things. So we've got a dark minim, a light minim, a dark minim here, animal statue, prismatic monument, which I haven't messed with yet, because I'm thinking that might send us somewhere. Light minim, airship quay. Block pass. So if I go here, it might bring me here. Exactly. But the airship isn't here now. Unless it's up above. Well, if we go here, That might bring us up here, and then we could talk to Perseia. We helped her earlier.
If you want a job done right,
then hit this thing. A sliver of darkness hangs before you, like the entrance of a cave, except there is no cave, only a tear in space. Within the darkness you see the glow of stars, and a cool night breeze wafts past you, carrying the scent of desert flowers and the echoes of sounds you are not hearing around you. If you step through that darkness, you might go anywhere, or maybe nowhere. It could be nothing but a shadow. Well, let's examine it more closely first. The cool air that sighs through it seems to follow you. The shadow does not change, no matter your perspective. You have the discomforting feeling that your attention on it has drawn its attention to you, that it is somehow examining, analyzing, and addressing you. Well, if you look into the abyss looks back at you. Or something very similar. I'm ad-libbing here. Let's walk into the darkness. You step into the darkness and it envelops you, then dissolves you into twinkling motes, drifting in a sphere of light. The light carries you through a black void, weightless, bodiless, selfless, towards another patch of starry sky. Then suddenly, you are somewhere else. Cool. As I thought. Oh. Loot.
On it.
20 shins. All right, now we can talk to Perseia. You know, you gotta have your priority straight. Hello there. You recognize this woman from the description that Amadon gave you in Sega's Cliffs. This is Perseia, Amadon's lost love, quote-unquote. She certainly doesn't appear as confused as Amadon made her sound. Instead, she's studying the necropolis with a frustrated expression. Yeah, why not? Perseia, isn't it? A man named Amadon was looking for you. I convinced him to give it up. Gold tide raised a tiny amount. You what? She says, whirling around. Her eyes are wide, pale circles. And you're certain he hasn't followed you anyway? She studies your face and relaxes. Thank you. You have no idea how much you've helped me. And she thinks, the idiot was so convinced I needed help. Is it so hard to just believe someone's words? She turns back to the necropolis. Damnable cultist, she mutters. I need to get back inside, but I can't risk... She catches your eye. Never mind. None of this is your concern. You've done more than enough. This is something I need to handle myself. Sure about that? She mutters. Oh, I can't really interact that much with her. What the hell is this thing?
All right.
Okay, there we go. Killer's tease? Oh.
Let's go.
Okay, here we go. A large upside-down pyramid floats before you, lit from below by a soft white light. It is made of weathered stone, but you can see lights and hear a faint buzzing through the cracks in its crumbling facade. Examine the pyramid. We must. You study it from every side. There's no inscription to explain why it was erected or by whom, nor is there any obvious way to interact with it. Just like most Numenera that we find. You do notice that the light from inside the crack seems to follow your hand as you slide it across. So perhaps it is reacting to you after all. A gentle white glow appears to be the only thing supporting this upside-down pyramid. A faint scent of something sweet fills the air. See, that's why I always click that again, because we get additional information. We didn't know about the sweet smell. Try to figure out how the pyramid works with our mystical lore. 100%. foam. Success! You slide your hands across the pyramid, following not the cracks, but the symbols and etchings on its surface. After a great deal of experimentation, and not a small amount of luck, you discover a specific pattern which causes the light to grow in intensity. As it does so, a soft warmth envelops you, refreshing your body and mind. As you feel better, however, the pyramid seems to grow more dim. We've restored, 2 intellect and 2 speed. Nice. You stop, not wanting to waste the pyramid's obvious healing power just yet. It should be saved for a time when you really need it. True. Let's come back when we have, really depleted stats. She mutters. Alright. Let's talk to this guy. Gotta be another way out of here. What's his name? Bericael Brunna. Hail. I said hail. Hail, damn you. You spindly little... Here we go. This androgynous woman... Oh, really? Okay. Projects an air of fearsome will. Her muscles are thin and wiry, and her body screams of sharp edges. She seems like a human stiletto. Her head is shaved, and she bears a tattoo of a Castoff on her scalp. Never seen you before. I'm Bericael. Bericael Brunna. She starts scanning the cliffside. How long you been awake since you moved out? Of your body, I mean. She thinks she's got that innocent idiot look. Changing gods already left her. Not very long. She nods. Figured you were new. Been spending time at the Endless Battle, so hadn't heard of your body. Suppose one of us should welcome you to our social club. She inclines her head slightly. Anyway, was on my way to Mila Vest with a message for Padge Reckon, but the portals are blocked. The cowards heard someone say the Sorrow's hunting again, so they locked the doors behind themselves. Padge will get her message later. I need to return to the Endless Battle. Tell me about Padge Reckon. She flashes a quick look of surprise. Oh, right. You're new. Padge is commander of the First Militia. Took up the mantle, keeping our cursed sire's forces contained. Smart woman, though. I thought the First was dead. She is. Padge kept the name in the First's honor. She doesn't care for the glory. Besides, our creator's carked. Fighting him is the best bet. Using the First name reminds everyone why we fight. Why would you fight the changing god? He's going to kill us all if he gets the chance. He wants to erase us. Thinks that's the way to stop the sorrow. We're not his children to him. More like broken clones, byproducts. He'd never sacrifice himself, but that's because he's the only real person in this world. Because he wants to do us all in just to save himself. I'll come back to this. Talk about something else. Tell me about the endless battle. If it's really endless, why keep fighting? She shrugs. Makes us stronger. Faster. Deadlier. More of what we are. Strips away the dross of life and makes experience shine. Peacetime life is dull and worthless, like watching life go past a veil, pass through a veil. War clarifies life, makes us better. Endless is a good thing if you keep that in mind. What can you tell me about Mila Vest? She stares at you flatly for a moment. You feel a tickling at the base of your mind, and she shrugs. See for yourself, if you can get in. They've locked themselves away. Think they're going to find answers while they're tucked away from the world. She shrugs. Place has its uses, true, but it's mostly a bolt hole from the world. Death comes for us all. Mila Vest is just a place to prolong the waiting. How are you going to get back to the endless battle? She points. I was looking at the pass to Cone Village, but it collapsed. Doesn't seem to be any way over these mountains, either. No matter. I'll find a different way. She glances at you sidelong and sneers. Sooner rather than later, I think. What's cowardly about keeping the sorrow out of Mila Vest? Hasn't found them there for hundreds of years, but now they say it's time to close the doors, like it's going to traipse in. Been telling them that if the sorrow tries hard enough, it'll get in. Can't stop that kind of power. What's the message you have for her? Maybe I could deliver it. Endless battle intelligence. Not for you. Okay. I'll be seeing you then. No, you won't. I'm done looking for a way over these twice-damned mountains. Gonna find a different way out of the valley. Been real good talking with you, though. Huh. The tone in her voice makes you question the veracity of that statement. Wait, you're leaving? Let me ask some more questions first. Her eyes reflect barely contained exasperation. I have no more questions. Good. With that, she strides off. See ya. Stop bumping into us. Okay.
Finally, something to do.
Ah, like investigate this thing that you're so scared about. Oh wait, that you're not scared about. Oh. No, I thought this was the alcove. Never mind, I've looked at that already.
Without doubt.
This is the blocked-off pass. A recent landslide has closed off what was once a pass out of the valley. Okay, so we've got a thing to look at here, which we already did. Pax. Thalana. Luca. Its name is Luca. In the Denovan Russ. Now this person's probably, I'm thinking, oh, it's a sleep location. We can go sheepies. We can go sheepies, yes. Let's talk to Marigali. Pay attention. I assure you that I am aware. Yeah, we've been through that before. Let's talk to all these people. Denovan Russ. The man looks up at you momentarily before looking away into the distance at nothing in particular. He takes a drag on his smoke. His presence strikes you as odd, as if something about him were trying to inspire dread in you. What's your name? Denovan Russ. He flickers a gaze at you, and then stares off into the distance again. He takes another drag on his smoke, but says nothing. You're not sure he even heard you. What are you doing here? Trying to get home. You see that woman? That's Thalana. You got questions? He points. Yeah. Talk to Thalana. What can you tell me about the valley? Nothing. Just dust and memories. Oh well. Mm-hmm. Luca. Do you live on the second floor? The man is busy reading a strange device, an elegant square of some kind of metal. Odd letters and images flash by on a reflective screen embedded in the square. When you draw near, you notice that the device is plugged into his arm with a long silver wire, and one of the man's eyes is mechanical. Greetings. His voice is kind, though it buzzes like a rattling sheet of synth-steel. I am Luca Marigali. I don't know how to make that voice, so I'm just gonna not try. He gestures with the book. Sometimes I read in the older tongue. I uncover great knowledge this way. For instance, his metal eye stutters and clicks, and a tinny voice emerges from the pad. Okay. The formal education of the young begins in utero, with nervous system uptake inhibitors and microwave transmissions to the developing fetal brain. He clicks it off. You see? I do not know the species to which this refers, but I begin to know of them. Microwave transmissions. At any rate, what can I do for you? Callisthenes says, I would very much like to examine you, with your permission. Perhaps we can speak of what you have learned? I would enjoy the opportunity to share my knowledge with someone who can understand my words. Perhaps we can begin to speak of what I have just read. Of a certainty, Callisthenes murmurs, stepping close to examine the man. They speak in low voices to each other as she runs her hands across his prosthesis. At last she smiles, thanks him for his time, and backs away. Fascinating, she says. His realities have been smashed together, and it is not merely his mechanical brain that makes him distant and emotionless. It is the juxtaposition of multiple words. His singular humanity is broken. Speak to him yourself, and judge his effect yourself. What was your name again? I need a drink. Hold on a second, guys. Did I not introduce myself? He closes his eyes. I did. I said, greetings. I am Luca Marigali. Perhaps your memory storage has been corrupted. He seems concerned. Say something else? Oh dear, your memory issue seems to have worsened. He speaks slowly. I am Luca Marigali. Tell me about yourself. He nods. I have spoken my name already. Quite a few times. The knowledge of my character is thus more important. I was a soldier. I travel with my friends. I and my friends travel to our home. Or at least this is our plan. He leans close. I admit to concern for my friends. They seem trapped in the past, paralyzed. They are not as they were when we set out. He gestures to the mechanical extrusions on his own body. Nor, to be fair, am I. Can you tell me anything else about yourself? He frowns. I am unwilling to commit personal details to a stranger. I have told you what I am willing to share. No more. What do you mean when you say your friends are different? They were full of hope once. We, and a dozen others, set out from our home, an aldea west of Sega's Cliffs, to find fortune in the endless battle. We joined a recruiter in Sega's Cliffs, and enlisted with the army of the Changing God. We thought we were prepared. We were not. We were in trenches. We fought with bolt throwers, energy weapons, and detonations. That first day saw half our friends obliterated by a rogue particle wave that emanated from our side of the battlefield. And then we woke again in a new reality, our memories of the old world intact, but our bodies whole, except for Timpo, who was half dissolved in this new reality. So it went, incremental gains as a whole, with certain consequences carrying into new lives. Sometimes they would undo all our day's heroism for an unseen advantage. Other times we'd lose a friend forever. One day I was caught half out of a trench, the air exploded above us, and I burned. The new reality did not restore me. I spent some weeks under the care of chirurgeons. When I awoke, I was as you saw me, and our other friends had been killed. Thalana and Denovan reacted very differently to me. They say I, too, have changed. I don't know. I know that I no longer fear. I do not remember much of emotion. I recall the fear and horror, but I do not recall its taste. And when I spoke to them, they agreed that it was time for us to leave. To leave before we became these forgotten names, lost in the flux of worlds. He thinks, Timpo, Zad, Brashiath, so many names, all gone. What can you tell me about the valley? It is a dry place. I tasted the water that bubbled up nearby. It was alkaline and induced strange visions. My new metabolism protected me from the worst of it. Had my friends tasted it, they might have died. I don't think I drank that. He looks down at his metal pad. We have found no bodies, nor anything of value. All is quiet, but this is a waypoint, not a destination. I would not remain here long. It is inimical to life. Safe travels. Okay, let's talk to Thalana Markarath.